My name is Gareth Davis, and I'm the head of the ESB ecars business. And in a few moments, I'm going to say a few words about electromobility and EVs. And this, of course, is the concluding event of this year's Great Electric Drive. But before I begin, I'd like to thank a few of the people who have made today possible. Firstly, I'd like to thank our EV ambassadors. I'd also like to thank our partners from the Irish car industry, Nissan, Renault, Mitsubishi, Citroen, and BMW. Within ESB, I'd like to thank our ESB ecars marketing team, who over the last year have worked tirelessly with the ambassadors. And I'd also like to congratulate them because this event has won the accolade of being shortlisted for an excellence award by the Public Relations Institute of Ireland. So congratulations to Sinead and her team for all of that. So I'm going to speak now about electric vehicles, but in a way, I'm not just talking about electric vehicles. I'm talking about how societies do change. And when I say do change, I don't mean incremental change. I mean deep seismic change that occurs over a number of years. So if you think about what's happening in electric vehicles, I think it's a lot like what has happened in the Irish economy and society over the last few decades. 40, 50 years ago, we lived in a world in Ireland where people made their living from doing things like bashing metal in factories, working on a farm as my father did. And today we're in a world where people do things like man call centers and build apps for a living. Now, looking back, that probably looks like it was inevitable. It likely looks like, it was seamless, but it wasn't. There were challenges along the way and setbacks. So, for example, we had mass migration in the 50s and the 1980s. There were also losers as well as winners as some industries restructured. But one interesting thing I think, and we think a lot about this in the ESB because we think about the future, it also required people to have vision, to step up, and to bet on the future. And one story that we think about a lot again within ESB is the Ardnacrusha power plant. So some of you are probably aware of this, but in 1927, the Irish government made a decision, and that decision was to take 20% of 1 year's budget and to spend it on building the world's largest hydroelectric power plant. And at the time, that produced far more electricity than Ireland needed at that time, many, many more times. Now, that was a great decision, and it was visionary. And it ended up creating enough electricity to underpin Irish economic development and to help make all of this happen for decades. So I believe that we're at a current juncture with regards to electric vehicles. We are at this moment in that industry and that part and that sector of our society. So today what I'm going to do is I'm going to share why I think we should make this shift, particularly in Ireland, why we should act to make that happen. And then at the end, I'm going to talk briefly about how I think we should make this happen. So there are three reasons I think that we should encourage electromobility. And those three are, firstly, we need to do it for future generations. We also need to do it to improve the quality of our lives today. And finally, we need to do it so that we can capture some of the business opportunities, the economic opportunities that this great shift that's happening globally will create. So in terms of future generations, two of the big public policy problems facing our society, and this is agreed nationally, globally, at the European level, are climate change and poor air quality. So in terms of climate change, I think, you know, everyone knows how important that is, and the G7 this week, at a time where there's a lot of short-term instability around the world, they're spending a big chunk of their agenda. The most powerful people in the world are looking to deal with that. Now, our vision within ESB around tackling this is we believe that the way that you can best tackle this is you can decarbonize the power supply, the electricity system through renewables and other forms of low-carbon generation, and then use that carbon-free energy to decarbonize other sectors of society. So, for example, heating, or particularly germane today to us, transport. So that's our vision. And today, I'm very happy to say, even today with our current mix of power plants, you know, which includes coal and gas plants, electric vehicles are so efficient that they have about 30% less carbon output per kilometer traveled than petrol and diesel cars. Now, a second major policy driver, I feel, and this one has a huge human context, is air quality. So, you know, and I'll put some numbers on this, which are very stark. In the United Kingdom, it's estimated that 25,000 people a year die from poor air quality. And road transport, the OECD estimates road transport in major Western industrial societies accounts for about 50% of all air pollutants. Electric vehicles can play a key role in helping to solve this problem. And today, major global cities, London, Paris, and Amsterdam, are turning to electric vehicles, not for reasons of climate change, although that's important, but to improve the quality of the air that their citizens breathe. The second reason, it's a lot more prosaic, but it's also important. Electric vehicles can improve our lives today. So people spend a lot of time in their vehicles. And, you know, for me personally, I love driving an EV. It's fast, it's got lots of torque. I love the fact that it's quiet. I just like the feel of it. In addition to that, it's superbly economical. So it costs about 1/7 the cost per kilometer traveled in fuel cost to travel by EV as it does by a petrol or diesel car. Now, you know, I'm saying this, and that's great and everything, but, and some of you may be a little bit skeptical. If so, I would encourage you to talk to the people who know EVs best of all, and that's EV drivers. Now, there's a lot of survey evidence out there. There's lots of data and stuff. And, you know, they all point to a single conclusion, which is satisfaction rates with electric cars are in the 90s. You know, it's unparalleled for forms of consumer product. Now, but I'll tell maybe just one story in terms of the evidence. Auto Express in the UK, they do a ranking every year of the top, you know, of the 500 or so vehicles that are sold in the United Kingdom. Now, a small fraction of these are EVs. But of their top 10, three of their top 10 most loved vehicles in Britain are electric vehicles. That's the Nissan Leaf, the Lexus IS, and the Renault Zoe. Now, in a moment, you'll hear from our great electric drive ambassadors, or rather from two of them, and they'll be talking about their experience, so you'll get to hear from them. But also, I saw Mr. Paddy Carroll here. I don't know where he's sitting, but yeah, there's Paddy Carroll. So Paddy is the secretary of the Irish EV Owners Association, and you know, I would encourage you, as well as speaking to our EV ambassadors, to talk to him and feel, you know, find out what how he feels about his car. Okay, and of course, you know, we hope to be part of that at ESB by creating the public infrastructure, over 1,200 public charging points north and south, that will make that driving experience even better. The third reason I think we should promote electromobility in Ireland comes down to euros and jobs. And let me just speak to this for a moment. There's some data up here, so please bear with me as I take you through it. But I think it's now indisputable that a major shift is happening worldwide in road transport. So back in 2011, whenever people were thinking about EVs and maybe mentioning the word white elephant in the same sentence, there were a few tens of thousands of EVs sold every year. But today, we're running at a rate of more than 700,000. And I believe that by the end of this year, we'll have sold 1 million electric vehicles this year. And there's headroom for future growth. If we come even closer to the United Kingdom, this time last year, there were about 12,000 electric vehicles on the road in Britain. By the end of this year, it's going to be 50,000. So think of that as a growth rate. And again, you know, they have ambitions there to go to 1 million or more in the next few years. Now, all of this is creating business opportunities. We're not traditionally a major car making industry, but Tesla, who are based in Southern California, they're an example of the type of opportunities that this is going to unleash. So Tesla were founded in 2003. And today, they're an all-electric vehicle company. Today, the U.S. stock market values them at $32 billion. So to give you some context, that's half the value that they put on the Ford Motor Company, which took, you know, more than 100 years to create and operates all over the world and is the market leader in many, many countries. So that's what the capital markets think of the future of electric vehicles. Now, they say that the future already exists, it just exists somewhere else in another country or another location. And if that's the case, I would encourage you to go to the Netherlands, which is the probably, along with Norway, the European leader in electromobility. Now, they started it pretty much around the same time as us. In 2011, they had less than 1,000 electric vehicles on the road there. Today, it's more than 50,000. And some of the businesses that you see there, their logos are up there. The New Motion, they're based in downtown Amsterdam. They employ about 100 people in high-tech online jobs. They're not an engineering company. They're an online and charging services company. And they're coming up with charging products and services for employers, dealers, individuals, councils, to help them manage charging. And they have ambitions to stretch beyond the Netherlands into Germany, Britain, and other countries. That's one example of a startup. Another one is Allego, and they were founded in autumn 2013. And they've just won the contract, beaten out very strong competition from the German power industry and German engineering companies to build and run the EV infrastructure in Berlin. And, you know, coming back to Ireland, we have representatives here today from M2C, a supplier that we work with, and we hope they'll be able to capture opportunities in the future, perhaps in Britain, where the British government is committed to spending £1 billion between now and the end of the decade on low-emission vehicles. We also have product back here from EC Charging at our stand, and you know, we're very hopeful that, you know, what we've done in Ireland will allow Irish companies and Irish people to capture those opportunities. Okay. So I've talked about the why, and I passionately believe in electromobility and why we in Ireland should push it. I'm going to speak now about the how. And I guess, you know, just looping back to the changes in Irish society that happened over the last few decades. Again, I think there are parallels. So those changes were difficult at times, but they also required people to bet on the future. And if you think about electric vehicles, that's the case today, right? So EV drivers are buying a product where there's not necessarily a huge secondhand market yet. They have to take that risk. The EV industry, or sorry, the motor industry has to put their sales and marketing year on. They have to spend their R&D money on developing and bringing to market and selling electric vehicles, whenever it's probably easier this year and this quarter to sell a petrol or diesel car. And we in ESB and other infrastructure providers, we have to invest ahead of the cars in the hope that they'll come. So this requires risk, it requires commitment. And to create the environment where this investment and this change can happen, we need all of society, we need multiple stakeholders to step up to the plate. So this, like Irish economic development, it was a societal process, and this is going to require society-wide support. Okay, so let me just talk about some of the key stakeholders that I think are important. I think local authorities are absolutely pivotal, given their role in our local towns and cities. And I'd like to salute Dublin City, also Dún Laoghaire, and the Cork councils who've been working with us over the past few months to help make our towns and cities friendlier places for EV drivers. National government has a critical role because we're going to rely on them to create the stable, enduring framework that will give other participants the confidence to invest and to make the switch. Infrastructure providers, we need to continue to invest and innovate to make the EV driving experience even better. And we're continuing to do that in ESB. So today I'm happy to announce that we're launching a new app that's an advance on what we previously had in. And we want to do even more on that front to make it a better experience. And then finally, the car industry. And the presence here today of so many senior people from the Irish car industry is, I think, a great testimony to their commitment to this category, but I'm afraid I'm going to ask them to do even more. And I'm going to ask them, just as I'm asking everyone else to do more and asking ourselves to do more, I'm going to ask them to bring even more makes and models to market. I'm going to ask them to, you know, to do even more marketing and, you know, to price their product as well, you know. So that's my ask and my call to action of everyone here. But last, I'm going to turn to the EV drivers. And I've already talked about how happy most EV drivers are with their product. And I'm going to turn to our EV ambassadors in particular, and I'm going to say the most powerful marketing media that there is word of mouth from someone that you trust. So if you've had a great experience with an e-car and you really like it and you've figured it's a great way to save money, or you just like driving it, tell people about it, share your experience, let people know, help everyone make that switch. So thank you. I'm now going to allow you to hear from two of our ambassadors directly. So first up, we have Mr. Steve Kelly, and then he's going to be followed by Guy Atkinson. Steve, by way of background, and I hope he doesn't mind me saying this, is an engineer and a pilot. And in the 90s, he worked on, I think, renewable energy. So I suspect he's going to be an exacting taskmaster around the technology. And Guy Atkinson hails from County Offaly and runs a farm. And I'll let him tell you a little bit more about himself, but he's got some very interesting views and assets in terms of the environment.